Welcome, friends. You are here with us for the EPC forum on leading our sessions and congregations well through issues of race and justice. We're going to wait just about a minute more and let folks join us. We have over 500 who have registered to be a part of this forum today, so we want to make sure everybody's able to get on. So give us just a minute more and we'll get started. It's fun to see who's on here, looking down the list. Zach Hopkins, how you doing, Zach? Mary Brown, Kathy McDonald, Mark Gregory, Ron Hill, Cameron Schaefer, Camille Ward, my goodness, Bucky Hunsicker. If you're just now joining us, we're going to wait just a little bit more, give people time to jump on board with us. Excited that there was such interest and participation in this forum for today. Paul Becker, how you doing, Paul? Matthew Atterbury. I've loved doing Zoom with different members of my church. Had a call the other night with our chancel choir, and it was tons of fun. There's Tanner Fox, the amazing pastor at my church. All right, friends. Well, let's go ahead and get started. Welcome. My name is Case Thorp. I'm the senior pastor at First Presbyterian Church of Orlando, and honored to serve you this year as moderator of the 39th General Assembly. So I'd like to open with a word of prayer, and then we will go forward with our forum, if you'd pray with me. Father God, I thank you for this miracle of technology that enables us as a family to talk together and to share. And Lord, I lift up to you our world, our country, our communities, and our congregations with such conversation about racial injustice. Help us, Father, to hear one another, to hear you, and to lead well in your name, helping our people walk more and more into the likeness of Christ. In Christ's name we pray, amen. Well, friends, we are here today partly due to the call and request of the National Leadership Team. They encouraged us on June 1st for team elders and sessions to consider acting as the Lord Jesus Christ leads, to speak out for justice and equality, to speak against racism, injustice, and equality, and to work to arrest the origins of civil unrest, namely poverty, racial separation, immorality, and a lack of radical love. Powerful statement, and I was honored to be a part of that conversation and even to put this out there. But then the question becomes how and in what way? We come from so many different types of congregations, settings, urban settings, suburban, those in various parts of our country, even in the Bahamas. And some of our churches are quite monolithic, and we've got some new church plants and other churches that have done well in seeing that their congregations reflect the body of Christ. Well, we have our essentials at a denomination, but it can be all over the map when we try to consider how do we understand race, how do we understand power, oppression, and what exactly does justice look like? So I wanted to gather some of the expert voices I know and dig a little bit and hear what they would have to say. So I'm sure you can see our panelists, and I'm glad to introduce them. Fellows, as I introduce you, if you would sign off and give us a hello. We've got Rufus Smith, lead pastor at Hope Church in Cordova, Tennessee, and co-chairman of the Revelation 7-9 Task Force. Rufus, thank you for hosting us at General Assembly, not this June, but next, or in September. Then Dean Weaver, lead pastor of Memorial Park Presbyterian Church in Allison Park, a suburb of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and co-chairman of our Revelation 7-9 Task Force, and our stated clerk nominee. Dean, good to see you. Tom Werner, ruling elder at Greentree Community Church in Kirkwood, Missouri, just outside of St. Louis, and current chairman of EPC National Leadership Team and moderator of the 38th General Assembly. Hello, Tomas. Glenn Meyers, whom I've enjoyed getting to know in this work, pastor of Ardara United Presbyterian Church in Ardara, Pennsylvania, near Pittsburgh, and our EPC moderator-elect. Glenn, welcome. Hello. And then Michael Davis, teaching pastor at Downtown Church in Memphis, Tennessee, that meets at the, or has met and will likely get back to the historic Claiborne Temple. And also, Michael is a new dad. Woohoo! Congratulations, Michael.
Thank you.
Yeah. He said a minute ago, if I look a little tired, you'll understand. So, dude, we understand. You've got to pass.
Thank you.
So we're going to hear from our panelists first, and then I'm going to direct a few particular questions, and then we're going to take questions from you. So I'm going to throw it to Brian Smith, our Director of Communications for the EPC, and he's going to explain to us how we could do the question and answer time. Brian?
Well, hello, everyone. Thanks for joining us. Appreciate you taking time this Wednesday afternoon to join us. If you have a question you'd like to ask the panelists, a specific one, or just any one of them to answer, if you will use the Q&A button at the bottom of your Zoom window, it'll be to the lower right, and it's the same if you're on a computer or if you're watching on a phone or an iPad. It's Q&A and has two little cartoon balloon type things. Push that button, a little dialogue will pop up, and you can type in your question, hit send, and all the panelists will see your question. It's as easy as that. Well, thank you for your participation. Case?
All right, great. Well, so I wanted to start off at the suggestion of a wise mentor with our white pastors and sharing why does this issue matter? And why are you leaning in and learning more and wanting to see ministry in this direction? I'll briefly share this issue of racial injustice and the desire for justice hit close to home when I was at Princeton Seminary, and me and two friends were publicly accused of racism with a student from Africa. And it was a horrible misunderstanding that blew up into a campus-wide protest and even a public shaming like I have never known. And when all of that subsided, even after a public chapel service, I doubled down on committing to see that this fissure in our society is dealt with, and dealt with using the love of Jesus and the redemptive values of the gospel. And growing up in the South, my goodness, I've learned so much about the way I was raised and how things need to improve. So that's one of the reasons I am in this conversation. I'd like to now turn to Dean and Tom and then Mike Moses in a minute. So Dean, why don't you take it for us?
Thanks, Case. And thank you to everyone who's taking the time to be here. It's an important time for us as a denomination, and I'm just grateful for your commitment to listen in and be a part of the conversation. I would say, Case, that probably there are three major reasons why. There we go. Can you hear me now? Okay. The first would be, to whom much has been given, much will be required. And I've been given a great deal, and I want to be responsible with that which has been deposited in me and given to me for stewardship. So I want to be using those resources that have been allotted to me well for God's glory. The second is very personal. I have seven kids, as many of you know. Three of those are biological and white. Four of those are adopted and black. Two from Africa, one from the West Indies, and one from the great mission surrounding Cleveland. And so this is very personal for me. I've raised four black children, and it's a conversation that happens around our dinner table, not in theory, but in practice. And so it has very personal implications for me. And finally, and maybe most importantly, I think this is biblical. From Genesis 1:26 and our understanding of the Imago Dei, all the way through the scriptures till we get to Revelation 7:9, I think our culture has brought in understandings of ethnicity and race that are not biblical. And I think God has given us the ministry of reconciliation. And so understanding biblically what is true and what defines reality is the foundation upon which I live and think is what should be important. So those would be my good 3-point sermon. I'll have a poem at the end.
Case, you're on mute.
Oh, yes, Tom Werner.
Yeah. I just want to add my thanks to those of you who have gathered. I am not a pastor. I am a lawyer by background. I want to direct my comments to people I suspect who are like me, white, not very much history in discussing race, but feeling the need to know and say more. I grew up in a white suburban home. There was a sense of fairness and care there, but not a consciousness of race or ethnicity. And most of my life, I held to the point of view that the problem of race was a product of slavery. And my family was still in Germany 30 years after the Civil War. And so this was not my issue. This was not my problem to take care of. I wanted to be fair. I wanted to be kind, but not my issue. 6 years ago, that began to change in me. I am a St. Louisan, and Michael Brown, a young African-American man, was killed by a white policeman in Ferguson, a St. Louis suburb. And I was taken aback by the fury that was expressed in the streets. Why was everybody so angry? As I began to look at this, I started with 3 questions. First of all, my first question was, does the Bible speak to race and ethnicity? Is this a biblical issue or a social issue? Secondly, I had to ask whether this was a present issue. Wasn't most of this taken care of by the Civil War and the Civil Rights Movement of the 1960s? And third, how can I talk about these issues? I didn't have the vocabulary, and I was afraid to say anything lest I offend someone. So those were my 3 issues, and I began to educate myself into minority culture and especially African-American culture. I read some books. That was my starting point. I read some white authors. I read minority authors. I read Christians, non-Christians. I read John Piper and Brian Stevenson and Leonce Crump. I read on the theology of race, racial history in the United States. I, as a lawyer, was not afraid to dive into public policy issues like mass incarceration and housing. Some of the books I agreed with, some of them I didn't. And I go through now at some of those books and I can see my angry notes in the margin. Don't be afraid to engage with people that you don't agree with. But I guess just keep your margin notes to yourself. We began to look at movies and videos. So I watched everything from the movie Selma to Beyonce at Coachella. I began to listen to hip hop on the radio. I must say that it's still not my favorite outlet, my outlet of my music of choice, but okay, I know it. I began to learn vocabulary like minority culture and majority culture. Phrases like the narrative of racial difference and be able to use those ideas in sentences. And I also began to develop some additional relationships. I don't want to make more of this than what it is, but after George Floyd died, I now had 5 people of color, men of color, whom I could call. And to let them know that I was thinking about them and I was praying for them. I was sorry for what had happened and what this represented at this moment. So that may not be very many, but it is 5 more than I would have had 6 years ago. I want to return for just a moment to my 3 questions because I suspect that I'm not the only one who had those questions. If there may be a fair portion of us who want to know and need to know, is this biblical? Is this important and relevant? And how can I learn to talk about it? Last comment that I'll make is that for me, the seminal event and the change in my heart was the death of Michael Brown. And we are going through a similar moment, a similar experience right now with the death of George Floyd, I would encourage you that if God is prodding you to address this issue, do not ignore that prodding. The short attention span crowd will move on to the next thing that happens in the news. Could be election, could be the reappearance of COVID, whatever it is, dig into this. Listen to that prodding. We need to be in this for the long haul. Case, I'll turn it back to you.
Thank you, Tom. I appreciate your honesty there. I also, many years ago, prayed for an African-American friend. I realized I had grown up at school and graduate school with all sorts of friends not like me, but you go off into life and you get into your tribe real quick. And Michael Acheson is a PCA pastor who is one of my dear, dear buddies. And I, too, have had lots of dialogue with him, especially in the last few weeks. Well, Mike Moses is going to appear on the screen for us here, and I've asked him, just as an extra voice, to share as well why this matters. He is a former moderator of the assembly and the senior pastor at Lake Forest Church, which I believe is now up to 5 campuses or so. He teaches on church planting for Reformed Seminary. So, Mike, would you tell us what drives you to these issues and concerns?
Thank you. And thank you, Case and others, for putting this on. I'm looking forward to learning and hearing from you all. And that's Gordon Conwell Seminary, Case, but thank you. I'd like to just make a few points of why this, in this moment, me and our church feels called to address it. And why I want to learn ways from you guys of how to do so, hopefully. And I'll just... I'm going to try to outdo Dean, and I have 4 instead of 3 points in my sermon. Number one is because we chose several years ago to enter into a committed partnership with a predominantly Black church for lots of reasons, and we are vitally in partnership with them. In fact, they're considering coming into the EPC, which would be my joy. So because we're partnered at the hip, they're almost like another campus of us. Their hurt is our hurt. They're hurting. They are experiencing trauma and PTSD, frankly, from what it means to live their lives. And so because they're hurt, we're addressing it as our church because that's our hurt. We're vitally connected in our identification with Christ. A second reason is the clergy networks in our city we've worked hard to have relationship. And it's very diverse. And all of the African-American clergy, including friends of mine and people I don't know, have asked us with one voice to say, white pastors, we're asking you to lead your flock, to listen to our lives, to listen to our lament, to listen to understand our experience. And you don't even have to agree, but can you try to understand the Black Christian faith? When we talk about evangelicals in America, a large percent of Bible-believing Christians are Black. And they're unanimous almost in their understanding that they suffer inequalities in the USA because of the color of their skin. And so they've asked us to listen. And Jesus says, even if your enemy asks you to do something, go do that times two. And so if our fellow clergy are asking, so we're leading our church to be in a huge listening posture instead of talking, especially about anything other than the main issue. A third reason for me is the Old Testament prophets, very broad brush, they're very clear that if court decisions and resource allocations are consistently breaking for one class of the population better than another, that they name that injustice. And so I don't need to argue about the word systemic or not. That's just the biblical definition of injustice. And they call the people of God, as the people of God, to act to change that and like not be okay with it. And again, our almost unanimously, our Black brothers and sisters Christians are telling us that's the case in America. So I need to try to understand that. The last thing, it relates to our denomination, how you all are leading us. Our eschatology says that this reconciliation will be done and perfected in the kingdom. Revelation 7:9. And we all know that because of that eschatology, we're to live as a signpost and a billboard for that kingdom now and to even smell like it. And so our eschatology tells me we have to engage to understand and reconcile and change things. So I appreciate you asking.
Thank you. I appreciate your emotions, your deeply held convictions here. Well, Rufus Smith, mentor and encourager who actually suggested this direct format, I'm hungry to hear your wisdom.
Well, I'm grateful that the conversation is being had, and I've been asked by several, of course, my opinion. And I must say that my first response to particularly my white clergy brothers and sisters would be, if you do not think that the moment, whether it's the centrifugal force of COVID, economic crisis, and civil unrest due to the protests and the seeds that breed this protest, if you cannot see that this is biblical and not just social or political, then I would say there's no need to really enter into these kinds of discussions. And so that would be the first thing I would say. And then the other thing I would say is, I think what African-American Jesus followers want to hear is this kind of discussion by their white brothers and sisters to see how it impacts them. Is this indeed, as Tom asked, a biblical issue or a social issue? And if you think it is a biblical issue and not just a social issue, then let the Holy Spirit lead you in how to deal with it. I'm going to stop right there, Case.
Okay, thank you. Glenn.
Are you able to hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, I'm told there may be a problem with my microphone, so just let me know if I'm not causing trouble or it's not clear.
Well, dude, I'm trying to catch up with you on the beard.
Well, you keep trying. You're doing all right.
I'm very jealous.
You're doing all right. Okay, so I want to respond to the question specifically as you're asking it. So would you mind repeating it for me?
I just wanted to get some opening words on your thoughts as to why, as teaching elders and ruling elders in the church, we need to be leaning into issues of race and justice and then leading our congregations likewise.
Before I talk about leading the church, it's a personal issue to me, of course. I'm biracial, and I was raised by my white family, never knew my black family. So I sit right at the intersection of what the culture is dealing with right now. I have six children, five of them are biracial, and I have nine grandchildren, and many of them are biracial. So this is, you know, of course, a personal issue, and I believe God has me here for this particular time. With regards to the church, and the reason it's important that we address it is because we're a movement of evangelical churches, and that means we're called out by God himself to address these issues, because the gospel transforms, the gospel changes things, and it's our responsibility to take the gospel to the world so that that can happen. And so these social justice issues are just one of the things that the gospel changes. That's what differentiates us from other social movements or political movements or social work or anything else that goes on in the world. We have the power of the Holy Spirit who has given us the gospel to change the world. So that's why I think we need to address this with our churches.
Wonderful. And now Michael Davis in hot Memphis.
How you doing? Again, my name is Michael Davis. I'm privileged to be here. Thank you for everyone for being here. I believe this is an important issue, primarily because all of us know that a strong, more robust understanding of our doctrine of humanity tells us that we are all made as image bearers, created in image and likeness of God. And in the emphasis of which my brother Mike Moses already pointed to, that likeness doesn't come into full glory until we see Jesus. And so the ministry that we've been entrusted to, which is reconciliation, causes us to give dignity that's inherent to every single individual created being on earth. Inherent dignity, worth, and value. The church's role is to do that in all respects, no matter race, creed, class, or gender. And so I believe it is our duty to provide that level of righteousness, not only in the aspect of spirituality, but in the way that we do it with our hands, our hearts, and our heads. And we do that effectively as Christians by trusting in God. So that's why I believe that this moment is important for us right now.
Okay, thank you, sir. Well, I'm gonna throw up a few questions to our panelists and then ease into your questions, participants, that you've sent us. So thank you. Let me, if I may, Rufus and Dean, go to you first. As co-chairmen of our Revelation 7-9 Task Force, I have recognized that we don't have a common approach to ministries in racial justice. And part of the reason why is there's so many voices out there and political, social answers to these things. Luke Johnston, a teaching elder at St. Luke Joy Church in Kansas City, asks, what are your thoughts on terms like critical theory or intersectionality? Mark Farrell, a buddy of mine in our presbytery, who's an African-American pastor at Tampa Covenant Church, asks, how do you respond to the term white privilege? So help us think through these terms and these categories and how we minister well.
Let me start first and say that by God's grace, I've been involved in multi-ethnic, multi-generational ministry for 22 years. I have never, ever used the word white privilege. I've never used the word or phraseology, critical race theory, intersectionality, or even white supremacy. I think the problem with us is, even as Jesus followers, we allow the colloquialisms of the world to shape our thinking. We have to reframe the thinking as into what the Bible actually says. So I've been able to teach people without using those words. First of all, they're unproductive, unnecessarily incendiary. When the Bible really talks about hatred or prejudice, indifference, justice, there's so much of the text that we don't have to be dragged into that pit of allowing the world to frame our thinking. And by doing so, we can teach our congregations as well. So it is unnecessary in my view. I'm not belittling the question, but it is unnecessary in my view to delve into those particular words and phrases, but do delve into what's behind it and how does the word of God address the seeds that breed this kind of unrest.
That's great. Thank you, Dean.
I would largely, it's seldom that I disagree with my brother and my friend, but I might expand that a little bit. I think Rufus is exactly right that we need to reframe reality according to the word of God. God determines what is really real. What we often see and experience is a distortion of that reality, and we have the scripture to reframe that as God has so ordered it. So I think we should always start from that biblical foundation. I'm not afraid to look at certain social theories insofar as I might find them helpful to understand and make sense of the reality and exegete the culture in which I live. I've always read theologians that I disagree with. I don't feel threatened by that. If I can learn something, measuring it always against the word of God, I won't. I mean, for example, critical race theory has got foundations in both Freud and Marx. So you have to be able to measure that against the word of God. They do not frame our worldview. That doesn't mean there aren't things that can be discovered there that could be helpful. Intersectionality, for example, helps us to understand a little bit about power structures. So understanding how principalities and powers work, even in terms of the way human beings have made social constructs to advantage different groups over the expense of other groups, that's just social exegesis, and it helps me apply the word of God into those situations. It doesn't determine my worldview. It doesn't determine my thinking, but I'm not any more afraid of that than I am afraid of going to the doctor and having the doctor give me a medical diagnosis. Doesn't mean I don't go on Google and see if it's right. I'm still gonna check that out, But I ground everything on the scripture as the inerrant, infallible, inspired word of God. But I'm also going to lean in and listen to things that help me understand this cultural moment in which we live so I can speak into it with gospel power.
Sure. Dean, I mean, I would understand that as common grace, those truths that others may come to that don't directly come from scripture, but all truth is God's truth.
We just have to be careful. You know, it's a slippery slope, right? That we don't start down a road that starts taking in the common grace and taking it for granted and start maybe believing things that are really antithetical to scripture. So we always have to measure those things against scripture. As helpful as any tool might be, we measure them against the scripture.
Rufus and Dean, I know many are awaiting your report from the Revelation 7-9 Task Force and some of your recommendations. Do you want to give us a hint or two at anything that's to come? But more importantly, what are your hopes for the work of your task force and our assembly in the coming years?
Well, one hint of things to come. The 38th Assembly granted the creation of a task force or commission, basically a research arm to help us put our finger on the pulse of where the EPC is with respect to the concept of Revelation 7-9, and that is how the EPC church can, within the 1-3-5 mile radiuses of local churches, better reflect their communities. In essence, how do we improve the delivery of the Great Commission with great compassion? And so one of the things that we are going to be asking the assembly is, now that the research is in, we've had many conversations inside and outside of the EPC, to ask if the assembly would allow us to continue the work, not as a research arm, but a resource arm, a resource for those churches who feel that it is a part of their mission in their current context to indeed reflect their 1-3-5 mile radius. And so I trust that we will be granted that so that then we can actually help churches with the nuts and bolts and resources, conversations, in order to help them transform the way they are being led.
Let me just add to that case, in that 1-3-5 mile radius, there may not be the ethnic diversity in one community that there is in another, right? The 1-3-5 around Hope Church in Memphis might look different than the 1-3-5 around Memorial Park in Pittsburgh. But the question is, how do we reach those people who are demographically not represented in our congregation? So Mark Shelfleton put something on about being a rural pastor, and have any of us pastored a rural church and ministered to people in those communities? And I have. I pastored for 7 years, a small church in the country. And I will tell you that while there isn't the differentiation in that community in terms of people of color, great socioeconomic disparities, great educational disparities, age disparities, and our church was not representative of the entire community. It was representative of just a small slice of our community and was all the poorer because of it. So we really want to help churches that can reach their 1-3-5 mile demographics to find the people that maybe are in their blind spots, that they see all the time, but they don't really think about that as a people who might be part of their fellowship. We do think, according to the Great Commission in Matthew 28, that this call to go to the ta ethne, to the people groups of the world, that much like the days of Pentecost, God has actually brought the peoples of the world actually to our doorsteps, and that many of our congregations, mine included, have people from different ethnic backgrounds that are actually in that 1-3-5 mile radius that we're not currently having as a part of our fellowship the way we would wish. So it'll apply differently to different churches because different contexts, rural, suburban, urban, southern, northern, eastern, western, all gonna look a little bit different. But the resourcing that Rufus has talked about is a tool that hopefully will help every church be the missional outreach into their own community and reach out to the people that perhaps they haven't reached out to yet.
And if I may add, Case, as America obviously is becoming more ethnically and age diverse, it's also at the same time becoming more Christian adverse. And so the improved delivery of the gospel is tantamount for our time.
Well, 10 years from now, 50 years from now, Revelation 7:9 suggestions have worked. How is the EPC different?
In short, I hope we look more, a little more like Revelation 7:9. I look and therefore I beheld from every tribe, every nation, every people, every tongue.
I think the EPC is also different in that it now or will have better the ear of the generation that sometimes sees the church as a step behind. And it gives us the moral authority if indeed we look like Revelation 7:9 and not just look like it on the weekend, but live like it during the weekday. It all of a sudden gives us another authority that we perhaps have not enjoyed, and many denominations have not enjoyed, and won't be viewed as irrelevant and out of touch by those who are unchurched and de-churched to some degree.
Somebody complimented you, Glenn, in the Q&A, and I've lost it now. I can't quite find it, but they were appreciative of your comments about how important it is to be Holy Spirit-led in such things. I'm just curious, you're a counselor primarily by profession, correct?
Yeah.
And yet also you're a lay pastor at your particular church. I'm curious where you've seen the Holy Spirit work in these, in this regard in a powerful way, and what encouragement you would offer.
Well, in the course of the conversation, it talked about, I actually do pastor a suburban, almost rural church. It's very small. It's predominantly white, although we do reflect the diversity that's available in our community, is actually in our church. What this reminds me of is that the Holy Spirit really is at work in making us the congregation that we are. God is bringing, God is gathering. And so it's interesting, the question, because the work that I do as a counselor is with adults who have intellectual disabilities and or behavior challenges. And it strikes me as we address issues of race and justice, stuff like that, we are all suffering from that idea that are gonna cause us some intellectual challenges and address issues of behavior that we have. And what that reminds me of is that God meets us where we are. And it's really important in my counseling work, you have to meet the person exactly where they are, but not allow them to stay there. And so I believe the Holy Spirit is at work in each individual person. And I believe my role as a pastor is to come alongside them and understand where are they on these issues and hear from the Holy Spirit myself as to what's the next step for that particular person. So I figured out that ministry is very contextual and even granular in terms of I'm working with an individual whom the Holy Spirit is already working with. So that would, yeah, that's my insight.
Thank you. Well, Michael, let me first throw it to anybody. Bill Brodine asks, is anybody familiar with Be the Bridge, a Christian curriculum on reconciliation? And then John Lyons asks, how can a local church be more multicultural? Very practical steps. I start with you, Michael, just because I know y'all have, from the very start of your church plant, cast that multicultural vision. Can you help, even for a monolithic church like mine, suggestions on very practical steps?
Yeah, I think three practical steps that I think are effective is education, evaluation, and creating the space or environment. First of all, I think education is important because the knowledge of our country, where we are, who we are, is vital for all of us to learn about one another, about backgrounds, about history, et cetera. And the educational component will help with empathy, right? Will help us to see the narrative that has been portrayed and understand how to engage in conversation when it comes to these matters. So you, the education helps you to answer somewhat of the why and the what. And then when you get to somewhat of the how, you evaluate. Education begins to help you to ask questions, which has been exemplified by what Tom was saying, that you begin to ask what was going on. He educated himself, and then he began to evaluate. And as he evaluated, that meant he asked, do I have any Black or Brown brothers or sisters in my life to walk with me, help me process, to think, to be empathize. And as he evaluated, then he acted and began to make those friendships. And I think many of us can do that, not just in our churches, but we can do it at a grocery store. We can do it at our local gym. We can do it while we engage people wherever we are and be intentional in those spaces. So then going to the space, creating safe space for people to grieve when they're hurting in our congregations. Because if we don't go through the five stages of grief, what happens is people who are angry, people who are in denial, people who are suffering from various different emotional, spiritual, and psychological issues due to the issues we have, it'll cause them to suppress. It'll cause them not to want to engage. And so creating those spaces where unfiltered dialogue can happen. And we see plenty of that through the Book of Psalm. God is not insecure about who he is. So what we say, how we go about it, we shouldn't be insecure, nor should we create silos that not allow people from various different backgrounds for their voices to be heard. And so that unfilteredness means that somebody may say something that you disagree with, but it doesn't necessarily mean that you have to voice your disagreement. Hear them, listen to them. All of us have been in relationships and we understand that listening is a huge component, and confrontation and uncomfortability it also comes with those spaces that we begin to create. So that's what I believe.
Okay, be the bridge. Do you know that, or does anybody on the panel know of that curriculum?
I am familiar with Be the Bridge. We plan to use that, but we have yet to use that here. What we have done particularly is we've been in a listening process, and that has been strong for us because Zoom, for many of us who do not like it, it's been a medium where when you're face-to-face, it's hard to have some of these uncomfortable conversations. Wow. But through Zoom, sometimes it's a little bit easier and less intimidating. So that's what we've been doing, listening to one another.
Okay, Rufus, did I see you respond that you know Be the Bridge?
Yeah, it's a good curriculum. I would advise pastors to look through it first, make sure that contextually, some resources are very strong in your face, and if that's where you think your congregation is or can handle, then do that. Others are more moderate, so you just have to look at it and contextualize it to your particular situation. Case, let me. This has nothing to do with your question, but. I also want to encourage people. I think when we lean into the Jewish-Gentile tension that the early church started with on day one of Pentecost, and we see it go on to the end of Acts, highlighted again in Acts 10 and 11, I think we have to keep our people focused biblically, that the hatred, the racism, the indifference, the callousness in the Jewish-Gentile tension is a biblical blueprint for the Black and white in America today, and in other tensions. They don't have to be Black and white. But keep our people focused on the Holy Spirit has handled these issues before, and therefore we simply learn from what he has taught us through Jesus's life, dealing with Samaritans and dealing with Acts chapter 2, Acts chapter 10, other passages that we are all too familiar with, and keep our people focused on the the biblical blueprint and then use as application points and illustrations current events.
Okay. Sorry, was there a bit of a pause? Can y'all hear me now? Okay, good. Thank you, Rufus. Anybody on the panel want to respond to that or share more?
Well, I think I would just add to what Michael said earlier. I think the first step and the first posture for us is probably one of listening and humility. And there's been discussion around, we just had a day of prayer and lament and fasting, but the posture of listening to the Lord, listening to one another, listening to our neighbors, our brothers and sisters who are in pain, that seems to be always a good place to start. In my sermon on Sunday, I did the uncharacteristic thing at the very beginning, and I counseled those who were watching that if they were angry, they might want to turn off the sermon. I mean, not often you get a pastor that says, stop listening to me. But I didn't think that someone could hear what I was about to say if they were just fuming. And there's a lot of anger out there. I still want people to hear what I had to say, but I wanted them to do so in a place where, the anger of man doesn't accomplish the righteousness of God. And a lot of us have anger, and we think that it's righteous anger when it in turn is actually self-righteous anger. A little dose of humility for those of us who are in the majority culture to be able to really take the time and listen and learn and grow. I would have thought that I knew a lot about this in the last few years. I feel like what I don't know is a lot. And I've dedicated myself to being, like Tom, a better learner. And that means being a better listener. And that's not intuitive for me. I'm not naturally a good listener, I confess that. But I'm trying. I'm trying to listen better and understand more and be less of the expert, actually. And actually, one of the great teachers for me is my son. My son is a 26-year-old black male, and he teaches me every night around the dinner table. And a big part of it is listening to him and understanding through his eyes what his experience is. And because I love him, I want to listen to him as opposed to try to lecture him on what it's like for him to be a black male. So I think all of us would do well to kind of take a little bit of a pause. Listening is not inactivity. It's not passive. It's a very active and actually a very challenging, difficult thing for many of us, especially preachers like me who are used to talking for a living. Listening and humbling ourselves and taking that initial posture. And I saw some of the questions, Case, not to look ahead, but I saw a number of the people saying, well, what kind of things could we do in our churches? And I would say one thing would be find people, other churches, other ministries, where you can sit down in groups of six or eight and share one another's stories. Listen to the story of the other, share your story. I'm not sure how many of us are familiar with our own ethnic story. Most of us think it's unimportant, but it's actually has a lot to say about who we are and who we have become. And so a little bit of self-exploration in terms of our own story, but more a listening posture to others, so that we can learn from their stories.
Well, Dean, I appreciate you saying that. Keith Fink asked a good question to our African-American panelists. Could you share with us what has been your experience as a black man in the EPC, and what do we need to know and hear? Is that too personal?
I just feel insufficient to answer it, that's all.
Well, no, I'm not asking you.
I've been in the EPC for 22 years. So the first thing about me is I believe that when a person becomes a Jesus follower and filled with the Spirit of God, that nothing and nobody can stop them from pursuing the plan and purpose God has for their lives. So irrespective of education, economics, I believe that God is in charge of my life, and as I'm walking in His Spirit, then nothing and nobody can stop me from pursuing that. I think we all believe that. On the practical side, with respect to being in the EPC, when I came into the EPC, there were less than five senior pastors, and I would say perhaps even lay pastors. That was 22 years ago. If you look at our numbers today, it is still as dismal. It's not, it has increased, but what that indicates and tells me, though, is that that has not really been a global focus. I use that word, a comprehensive focus, on the EPC becoming a church that looks like America. And so I'm encouraged at this time that real discussions are happening, if not nationally, regionally. But I think you have to bide your time and wait patiently for any move of God. I came into the EPC knowing that I would be a minority. I didn't expect that it would change necessarily overnight, so I'm not complaining at all. But I am saying that there is, it's easy to have a blind spot to those who are minorities in the EPC and to some of their issues that they're dealing with pastorally and personally. And so there certainly has been some lack of sensitivity, but I get that. That's not offensive to me, but it is a wake-up call for the rest of us to make sure that I am attending to the needs or concerns of my fellow brothers and sisters.
Yeah, you mentioned sisters. I am thrilled that we had Cheryl Mendez Ellis, from a candidate for ministry at our church, as a teaching elder, just graduate Reform Seminary. And I believe she might be the only African-American woman teaching candidate in the country. If I'm off on that, somebody email me. But Michael, Glenn, how has your experience been in the EPC as a Black man?
Are you able to hear me?
Okay. Yes.
From my experience, I've been very graciously received, but it's not unusual for me. What I have found in working with the national leadership team and others around the denomination is that there is a very real sincere desire to figure this out and to get it right. And that feels really good. When I got to the point of leadership, I had to explain to folks, as I explained a little bit earlier, that I may bring color to the table, but I don't bring culture to the table. My experience has been predominantly white all my life. And so I'm as anxious as everyone else to see how we are talking about these kind of things. It's a new experience for me to be able to talk about these things in a position of leadership like this. So I really do believe God's, you know, doing a work, but I'd like to testify to the very sincere desire to like figure this out and to get it right for the sake of God, for the glory of God.
Well, my friend, I think you are just the man for such a time as this. I love you serving with you. Michael Davis, last word.
Yeah, as many of you are hearing from Rufus, Glenn, my two older brothers, from the three of us, you will hear different experiences generationally, culturally, and even the way that we had upbringings, which, having said that, there's diversity within Blackness. Diversity is not a monolithic thought. Therefore, my experience and many experiences around the EPC, they vary. And so my experience has been different in various different ways, but I would say I would attribute my resiliency, meaning tolerance and patience in this matter, to be one that I'm thankful to the Lord that being at Second Presbyterian Church for a while and now at Downtown Church, I've had the opportunity just to be in spaces and to immerse myself in conversations and dialogues that, I mean, I did not, as a Christian, grow up having those conversations and dialogues necessarily. So my experience in some regards, I have been learning and growing. But then at the same time, what's challenging for me as a pastor is to see my Black and brown brothers and sisters struggle. Struggle with whether they should be a part of what we're doing, and always having to feel as if that I'm selling people on something. I don't want to sell anybody on anything but the gospel, the good news about Jesus Christ. And I'm not talking about an empty gospel, one that is half full. I'm talking about a full, substantial, robust gospel that transforms the lives of individuals, no matter the race or the creed. So as an African-American man, there is a part of me that feels in these current times a little discouraged, and also just sensing the pain of people that I shepherd, knowing that they have to engage these matters, and they feel like they have to bottle and suppress so many things up. So I'm more so empathetic for my Black and brown brothers that are in my congregation, and it makes me realize where we are. And that just kind of summarizes my experience.
Mm. Thank you. Thank you for that. And panelists, I want to thank you for your time, especially our African-American brothers. Your honesty, your vulnerability, your willingness to share and help the rest of us learn is invaluable. And I just pray that our church can keep moving forward on such things. Participants, I thank you for joining us. Don't forget to register for General Assembly in September. Registration will be opening up sometime this summer, but go ahead now and block out those dates, September 17th and 18th. To be with us at Brother Rufus's church. Always warm hospitality there at Hope in Cordova. Thank you. And let me say a closing word of prayer and we'll sign off. Father, I'm grateful for this time together. I pray that you would keep our hearts open, keep helping us listen and listen deeply. Bring those of us who aren't in relationship with someone very different than us. Bring us into relationship in a way that is genuine and authentic, that we can then see things in ourselves and in this world that we never could imagine, and to see how your gospel meets every bit of it. Thank you for our congregations and the opportunity to lead. May we lead well and unto your name. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Thank you, panelists. Bye-bye.